days and then I'll fly away to a land where joy will never end. I'll fly away. Die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away.
Awesome and powerful. fears and doubts, they can all come too, 'cause they can't stay, Lord, when I'm here with you.
Savior and my God. Hallelujah. the risen Son of
the seal and open the scroll. you are worthy. God, you are holy. God, you are righteous. You are good. And you are good to those, Lord, who serve and follow you and who bow their knee to you, God. And Lord, the blessings that you pour out, God, and the things that you do for us, Lord, we don't deserve any of it, God, but you delight to bless your children, God, and thank you so much, God. There's so much to be thankful for, so much to sing about. Lord, may every heart in this room, Lord, every voice in this room be lifted up to their Savior tonight, and that we would be prepared, God, for not only the teaching and the study of your word, but we'd be prepared to be on our knees before you in prayer, God, serving in that way, God. Thank you so much for this time. Pray that you bless it. In your name I pray. Amen. Go ahead and greet each other.
the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before Him.
Who can stop the Lord Almighty? 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 Who can stop the Lord? Lord, have your way in me.
thank you for delivering me.
For delivering me.
Lord, I want to thank you for what you see in me.
For what you see in me.
Where home.
the things of your heart.
Holy stream from heaven, send to us we pray, let us drink again. Holy stream from heaven, bring new life today, let us breathe again. Oh Lord, let us breathe again.
You're trying to speak to us, and we ask that your Holy Spirit would do the teaching tonight, that he would be the one leading us into all truth, God. We praise you. We love you, Lord. Have this time right now and feed us, God, from your word. We ask in Jesus' name, amen. All right, we're in we're in Ezekiel, there we go. We're in Ezekiel chapter 23 tonight. So, more of like a PG-13, I guess you'd call it, study. There's women's brunch tomorrow, if you haven't noticed, going on, and that's at 10:30. You can bring your daughters of all ages, welcome. There's a men's study tomorrow, and you can bring your sons of all ages, I'm assuming. Yeah, that'd be fine. Okay, very good. All right, well, Father, again, just bless your word. Open our understanding, God, we ask in Jesus' name, amen. Ezekiel 23, the word of the Lord came again to me, saying, Son of man, there were two women, the daughters of one mother. They committed harlotry in Egypt. They committed harlotry in their youth. Their breasts were there embraced. Their virgin bosom was there pressed. The name was Ahola, the elder, and Aholabah, her sister. They were mine, and they bore sons and daughters. As for their names, Samaria is Ahola, and Jerusalem is Aholabah. Now, Ezekiel concludes this current series of prophecies with an extended prophetic parable here. This particular series of prophecies began in chapter 20 and were given in the seventh year of Ezekiel's captivity. The leaders of the nation who had been taken into captivity, they're thinking that they're going to be released at any time and wondering what's taking so long, didn't realize they're going to be there the rest of their lives. So they come to Ezekiel's house, it says in chapter 20, verse 1, to inquire of the Lord. Their inquiry was really a mockery of God because they had no intention of obeying him. They're just looking for some answers. They're coming to God's spokesman, Ezekiel, in the same way that liberal theologians or higher critics come to the Word of God today. They come as its master, not as its servant. They stand in judgment over God's word. They'll tell you which parts are literal, which parts are not, you know, which parts you can trust, that kind of thing. as though they were the authority over what God says instead of bowing to God's authority. So they come, let's hear what God has to say, and we'll determine if it's correct or not. We'll decide if we're going to follow it or not. So with these prophecies, God has Ezekiel proclaim judgment upon them. They're not getting the answers they're looking for. They're getting a proclamation of judgment upon the nation rather than appealing to them to repent, warning them as he has throughout the previous studies. These series of prophecies are only expressing why the destruction of Israel and Jerusalem and the temple was about to take place. Almost like, you know, for posterity's sake, because they're not listening, but so that those of us who read it years later can understand that God is serious about his word. And so, as I pointed out while we've gone through these prophecies, the reason that there is so much emphasis, and there's multiple prophecies speaking of this destruction of the nation, and the reason there's so many of these prophecies, so much emphasis here in the Bible upon the destruction of Jerusalem and Israel, is because Israel's not just any other nation. Jerusalem is not just any other city. Israel was chosen to play this central role throughout history in God's plan of redemption for all of humanity. It's very important. They are the ones entrusted with bringing God's revelation of himself here in the Bible to the rest of the world, so they're held to a higher accountability. They are under the microscope, as you will. Israel is also God's example to be followed or not followed, depending on how they're acting, according to 1 Corinthians 10. And they're also the people through whom the Messiah, the Savior of all people, was to come, not the Chinese, not the Australians, not, you know, the French, whoever, the Jews. And so the most important nation throughout history, and Jerusalem is going to be the central city in the coming millennial kingdom. And so the demolition of that city and the dispersion of this particular group of people is of greatest interest and important to those of us upon whom the end of the age has come. To study this, why has God done this? God uses repetition like this to implant spiritual principles to ensure that spiritual instruction is understood carefully by those who call themselves his children. So here instruction is brought via this parable. Two women, verse 2, daughters of one mother who committed harlotry in Egypt. They committed harlotry in their youth. Their breasts were their embrace. Their virgin bosom was their breast. Their names, Ahola the elder, Aholibah her sister. So the nation is identified clearly. Ahola means her sanctuary. Aholibah means my sanctuary in her. These sisters represent the northern kingdom of Israel and the southern kingdom of Judah. The names represent the situation that took place at the time that the nation split after King Solomon died. Jerusalem had the sanctuary of the Lord, the temple. Samaria, under Jeroboam, set up their own sanctuary, worship of false gods. They are daughters of one mother because they are two halves of one nation. They are two women because the Lord, Jehovah, had married them. Ahola is called the elder. Aholibah is called the Judah. Ahola's elder, literally the greater, because 10 tribes were represented in her and belonged to Samaria. Aholibah is Judah, represented by Jerusalem. Only had two tribes. They committed whoredom in Egypt, it says, in their youth, verse 3. In other words, they defiled themselves with the idols in Egypt in lewd and obscene ways while still a young nation. The Jews were pagan idolaters in Egypt before God delivered them. And so that sets the context for this extended parabolic prophecy. Verse 5, speaking of the northern kingdom, Ahola played the harlot, even though she was mine, God says. She lusted for her lovers, the neighboring Assyrians, who were clothed in purple, captains and rulers, all of them desirable young men, horsemen riding on horses. Thus she committed her harlotry with them, all of them choice men of Assyria, and with all for whom she lusted, with all her idols, she defiled herself. She has never given up her harlotry brought from Egypt. So this is the northern kingdom, just continued on in idolatry. In her youth, they had lain with her, pressed her virgin bosom, and poured out their immorality upon her. Therefore, I have delivered her into the hands of her lovers, into the hand of the Assyrians for whom she lusted. They uncovered her nakedness, took away her sons and daughters, and slew her with the sword. She became a byword among women, for they had executed judgment on her. So the sin of Ahola, the northern kingdom, was their intimate association with the Assyrian Empire, a relationship with the ungodly world, is what it was. The northern kingdom's alliance with Assyria led to their eventual downfall. What began as flirtation, the way the language is used here, they began just flirting with the world, developed into a sexual relationship that ended up destroying them, just as a constant contact with sin will pollute my conscience and render it powerless. If I think I can play with sin, if I think I can flirt with the world, my conscience will grow weaker and weaker. And pretty soon, the whole reason God gave me a conscience will be powerless to fulfill the purpose for why it was implanted in me. That's what you see many people today do. They have no conscience whatsoever. You think, what are people doing? How could they even do these things? Well, their conscience has been completely eliminated. What may begin as just a small diversion very often ends up just consuming a person and changing them into something that they never thought they would be. It's like this scientist in 1868, he imported a few gypsy moths into this country to crossbreed with silkworms in Melbourne, Massachusetts. He had a small cage, about five of them in there. One night, two of them escaped. And he began to freak out, and he ran to the neighbors, and he told them, you know, two of my moths got loose. You got to help me, you know. And they're thinking, who is this guy? It's two moths? Dude, what's the big deal? And they called him a fanatic. 20 years later, every bit of foliage for miles around Melbourne was destroyed. And now they spend millions of dollars every year just trying to keep the gypsy moth population under control in all of New England, because of two escaped moths. That's similar how sin enters the world through one man, spread its death to everybody. Because of the northern kingdom's break from the temple, you know, they never went back to their worship down in the southern temple down there in Jerusalem. Their break from that and their worship of God, they became susceptible to the idolatry of surrounding nations, depicted as being allured by the Assyrians, clothed in purple, verse 6, their captains and their rulers, desirable young men. The things of the world began to look very appealing to them. Just how people, you know, they don't go to church, they start compromising that. Pretty soon, you know, the world, they just think it's, you know, the normal place. It's the place I should be. And it begins to draw them in. You're either in one or the other. You can't be halfway. The world's too strong. Things of the world began to look appealing. Verses 7 and 8 describe the northern kingdom's eventual alliance with the Assyrians in terms of a wife committing adultery with another man. Therefore, God says in verse 9, I have delivered her into the hands of her lovers, into the hand of the Assyrians for whom she lusted. Then covered her nakedness, took away her sons and daughters, and slew her with the sword. She became a byword among women, for they had executed judgment on her. So here the very ones that they made alliances with, that they fell in love with, turned on them and destroyed them. You know, the traitor who comes over from the enemy's camp is often regarded with suspicion. Many times, they're met with contempt when they expect rewards because I've, you know, defected over to your side, but they're always under suspicion. And they think they're going to be rewarded, you know. They're thought, well, you're just some sneaky person. A traitor's zeal in the service for their new masters looked upon as being an effort to ingratiate themselves for their own purpose. You know, they're always suspect. You know, why are they being so good to me? That's the way it is for a person who goes back to the world after serving the Lord. The world becomes the instrument of their punishment. The backslider, usually, you know, if you know anyone who's backslidden and you've seen people backslide, they usually become greater sinners than those that they end up hanging around with. So as to convince, you know, their new master that they're entirely with them, they have to show themselves, and it becomes worse. Samaria, the northern kingdom, and their relationship with Assyria is well documented in how it went down outside of the Bible even. There's a monument from around 841 BC called the Black Obelisk of Shalmaneser. It's a limestone block. It's 7 feet tall, four sides, engravings on every side. It exists in a museum in London today. It's got an engraving of Jehu, son of Omri, on it. If you know your history books of the Bible, a king of the northern kingdom, his name is engraved, pictures of him bowing down to the Assyrian king, something that's not mentioned in our Bibles. But when you study the Bible, you see that it totally fits. You're studying in light of these historical artifacts, put it together with what the Bible says, it's presumed that King Jehu, 2 Kings chapters 9 and 10, he sought an alliance with the Assyrians against Syria. And they were a direct threat to the northern kingdom, so he went to Assyria. And he formed an alliance. It's pictured by him bowing down in allegiance to the Assyrian king, which would also agree with this parable right here. How the northern kingdom went and, you know, went after Assyria, forged a relationship. Two other northern kings, Menachem and Hoshea, also paid tribute to Assyria, according to 2 Kings chapters 15 through 17. The prophet Hosea rebuked the northern kingdom for their alliance with the world, like the Assyrians, and their unreliance upon God. But the northern kingdom, after submitting to the Assyrian authority, they served them until they ended up being violently conquered by their supposed allies, their lovers, as it's depicted here. The judgment that came upon the older sister, Ahola, served as a warning then to the younger sister, Aholibah, you know, the nation of Judah. When sinners, you know, can no longer render a service in the world, they render a service by being a warning to others. They can't do anything else, but they can become a warning. That's what the northern kingdom became to the southern kingdom. But rather than taking heed from what happened to their countrymen in the north, the southern kingdom of Judah became more corrupt. As it says in verse 11, now although her sister Aholibama, the nation of Judah, saw this, she became more corrupt in her lust than she, the northern kingdom, and in her harlotry more corrupt than her sister's harlotry. So the southern kingdom is spoken of as becoming more corrupt than the northern kingdom. She lusted for the neighboring Assyrians, captains and rulers, clothed most gorgeously, horsemen riding on horses, all of them desirable young men. Then I saw she was defiled, both took the same way. Then I saw that she was defiled, both took the same way, but she increased her harlotry. She looked at men portrayed on the wall, images of Chaldeans portrayed in vermilion. So this would be Babylon. So the initial alliance was with the Assyrians, but in alliance with Assyria, the southern kingdom then began to form relationship with the nation of Babylon, who are portrayed, images of Chaldeans portrayed in vermilion, girded with belts around their waist, flowing turbans on their heads, all of them looking like captains in the manner of the Babylonians of Chaldea, the land of their nativity. As soon as her eyes saw them, she lusted for them and sent messengers to them in Chaldea. And so this parable now would begin to hit home to these leaders from Judah who were assembled in Ezekiel's house to hear a word from the Lord. Oh, this is speaking of us, they would figure out. This is purposely, you know, very graphic, very belittling rebuke, using language that would drive home the point. Not only did Judah form an alliance with the Assyrians, as a similar language from verse 6 is repeated in verse 12 here, but Judah went further, and looking upon portrayals of those from Babylon, verses 14 and 15, who looked even better than the Assyrians. See, this is all couched in this, you know, like sexual language to press the point home to these people. This is how I was looking from God who married these nations, this nation. The images described here answer exactly to engravings and sculptures that have been found in excavations of ancient Assyrian palaces. What's described here, the girded belts and the flowing turbans and the looking like captains in verse 15, those depictions there have been found in engravings. And through an alliance with Assyria, this is saying, Judah was exposed to the displays of Chaldea or Babylon and to their beauty. And they looked even better than Assyria, and they fell in love with Babylon. Just by looking at the pictures, this is saying, just by seeing depictions, not having actual interaction yet, but by seeing the pictures of the Babylonians. Ooh, who are these people? It's like presently there are more outlets for pornography in our country than there are McDonald's restaurants. That tells you the state that our country is in. And rape statistics are proportionally higher in states with higher pornography sales than those with lower sales. Go figure. According to Richard Drake, professor of Brigham Young University, pornography is as mood-altering and addicting as cocaine. The same chemicals are released into a person's brain. You don't think, you know, pictures can trap a person? They certainly can, dude. And you must know people, probably, as I have, who have been completely addicted to this stuff. The Israelites in Judah cast their eyes upon Babylonian engravings, and as soon as her eyes saw them, verse 16, she lusted for them, sent messengers to meet these people. Then the Babylonians came to her into the bed of love, and they defiled her with their immorality. So she was defiled by them and alienated herself from them. She revealed her harlotry and uncovered her nakedness. Then I alienated myself, God says, from her, as I had alienated myself from her sister, the northern kingdom. The result of Judah and Jerusalem turning to an alliance with Babylon was that they found them to be harsher than the Assyrians, more violent. So she, Judah, verse 17, alienated, tried to back off and back away. She tried to separate herself from Babylon, but she couldn't. And it was at that time, verse 18 says, that God alienated himself from her, as he had done from the northern kingdom. And so they're going to keep flirting with the world. God pulls back and says, have at it. There's an interview with Ann Graham Lotz, a daughter of Billy Graham, on the Today Show after the 9/11 attacks. And she was asked by the interviewer, how could God let something like this happen? And she gave the very poignant response. She said, I believe God is deeply saddened by this attack, just as we are. But for years, we've been telling God to get out of our schools, get out of our government, get out of our lives. And being the gentleman that he is, I believe he has calmly backed out. How can we expect God to give us his blessing and his protection when we demand that he leave us alone? This is the same thing that happened with Israel, Judah, the Jews. With Judah, the younger sister now, Aholibah, with her, God initially removed his hand of protection. Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, took over the nation. But instead of turning to God in repentance, she sought more help from the world instead of from God by turning to Egypt, verse 19. So God alienated? Is she going to repent? Is she going to come to God? No. Yet she multiplied her harlotry in calling to remembrance the days of her youth when she had played the harlot in the land of Egypt. For she lusted for her paramours, whose flesh is like the flesh of donkeys, and whose issue is like the issue of horses. Thus you called to remembrance the lewdness of your youth when the Egyptians pressed your bosom because of your youthful breasts. Show God's disgust with Judah's course of action. Ezekiel uses particularly strong language here, which describes the Israelites' full circle of sin now, which brought them back to the very nation who had originally defiled her and who had originally enslaved her through idolatry. In the book of Jeremiah, it records how both Jehoiakim and Zedekiah, two of the final kings of Judah, they both rebelled against Babylon and sought help from Egypt and Egypt's false gods. Therefore, this punishment is coming upon her. This coming judgment of destruction of the nation, of the city, of Jerusalem, the temple, is proclaimed here in a fourfold prophetic judgment, with each proclamation beginning with, "Thus says the Lord God," or "This is what the sovereign Lord says." In verse 22, "Therefore, Oholibah, thus says the Lord God, behold, I will stir up your lovers against you, for whom you have alienated yourself, and I will bring them against you from every side, the Babylonians, all the Chaldeans, Pekod, Shoah, Koah, all the Assyrians with them, all of them desirable young men, governors, rulers, captains, and men of renown, all of them riding on horses. And they shall come against you with chariots, wagons, war horses, with a horde of people. They shall array against you buckler, shield, and helmet all around. I will delegate judgment to them," God says, "and they shall judge you according to their judgments. I will set my jealousy against you, and they shall deal furiously with you. They shall remove your nose, your ears, and your remnant shall fall by the sword. They shall take your sons and your daughters, and your remnant shall be devoured by fire. They shall also strip you of your clothes and take away your beautiful jewelry. Thus I will make you cease your lewdness and your harlotry brought from the land of Egypt, so that you will not lift your eyes to them nor remember Egypt anymore." And so her punishment is going to come from the very one she ran to for protection. God says it's going to come from every direction there. They'll bring them, in verse 22, "I will bring them against you from every side." You watch the news today, Israel is being placed once again in a very precarious spot. Just this last week, you know, Netanyahu announced that, you know, they are ready for an attack from every direction in their country. And we don't know all the particulars, but they've been sending delegates to our country over the last week, and they give a good show. We don't know what they're saying, but by what's going on, you can tell that our government seems to be isolating Israel at this point. Both our the wife of the president and Antony Blinken, our foreign policy guy, both of them are going to be in the Middle East this week, meeting with Jordan, meeting with Egypt, meeting with Lebanon, places like that, but they're not going to go to Israel. They're isolating them and making them trying to make them do what they want them to do, forcing them. But the Israeli government is having none of it, and they're standing their course, and so things are heating up once again. It's very similar to things you read in the Old Testament, where Israel would be closed in and God would put them in that place so they'd have to cry out to him. And so it's going to be a very interesting coming week, what's going to happen, and you know, that's something to definitely keep your eye on, because you know, when these things start to take place, it will take place very rapidly. Back in these days, God says he will stir them up, verse 22, and bring them against her. He names all the different people groups in verse 23 that would combine their forces to sack Jerusalem. It consists of various tribal groups that were all part of the Babylonian Empire. These smaller nations would show their loyalty to the Babylonian Empire by joining these military expeditions they would go on. But God in his sovereignty says he is the one delegating the judgment. So he names these nations ahead of time who are going to invade Jerusalem. Verses 25 and 26 describe the horrible details of Babylonian takeovers, where they would have facial mutilations. They would cut people's noses, ears off. That was common. Those that were left in the city trying to escape would just be killed, who weren't mutilated first. Sons and daughters, it says, would be valuable as slaves, so they would be kept alive. Everything of value would be confiscated. And that is what it would take, according to verse 27, that's what it's going to take to bring an end to Israel's idolatry. You study the history of Israel in the Old Testament, all the way back to the time of Judges, you see God bringing judgments against their idolatry as warnings. All along, various enemies would rise up against them, and they would cry out to God, and he would send a deliverer, a judge. During the time of Samuel and Saul, it was the Philistines continually attacking the nation, continual aggression. And they'd cry out to God, and God would save them. In the book of 1 Kings, there were famines, and in the 2 Kings, various enemies would come against Israel and trying to wake them up to return to God, always growing more and more deadly, the Assyrians, the Babylonians. But all those attempts failed. You study the whole history there of Israel, all those attempts failed, and so the northern kingdom, they were taken into captivity. Two tribes left. But that judgment didn't even cleanse the remaining people in the southern kingdom from turning to idols. And so the complete destruction is going to require a complete destruction of the nation, a complete destruction of the capital, almost like God's going to wipe the slate completely clean, remove all the remaining people from the land, and begin over. It'd be the only means by which God can cleanse the land. As he says there in verse 27, thus I will make you cease from your lewdness and your harlotry, brought from the land of Egypt, so that you will not lift your eyes to them nor remember Egypt anymore. So this final judgment is portrayed in these series of prophecies. Through this, in this final judgment, this is going to make Israel cease from their idolatry, their lewdness, it's called, that they brought with them from Egypt at the very beginning. It would cure them of it, basically. They're going to be cured of idolatry so that they will not lift their eyes to their idols nor remember Egypt ever again. That's a very amazing prophecy when you consider it. Because here's a nation of people perpetually prone to idolatry, their whole existence. They're finally conquered, and they're taken into captivity to the most notorious idolaters on the planet in Babylon. They're taken there into captivity, the place of idol central. They should have ended up succumbing to the temptations of Babylon. You know, any other nation would. And they should have ended up the same way, just succumbing to the idolatry there, never to be heard of again, but they didn't. They got cured. That's what's so amazing. This is what it took, unfortunately, to totally eradicate idolatry from their midst, from that captivity on. Israel never fell back into idolatry. They were never idolaters again. They never worshipped, you know, false gods, but they would only worship the true and living God alone. But you think, what other nation in the history of this planet ever went through stuff like this? None. This is the one nation. This is evidence of the sovereignty and omniscience of God. He clearly saw in advance the results that this destruction is going to bring upon the people, and he sovereignly allowed it for his eternal purposes. It doesn't mean, their history is meant here to teach me lessons. I'm to learn lessons through what they went through, according to 1 Corinthians 10, according to Romans 15. This is all preserved for my learning, our learning as Christians. I'm to learn from this, that history is meant to teach me lessons of how faithful God is in not giving up on those who belong to him. It's to give me great comfort, especially as when I struggle through things, and know that God, he's not going to give up. It doesn't mean I'm going to be spared hardships and trials. Instead, those are going to be used to thoroughly cleanse my life of everything that keeps me bound to the filth of this world. And while it isn't easy, I can be grateful that God cares enough about me to even go through the process. He could just say, get lost, too bad for you. But you think about it, the fact that there is a process, that God is orchestrating a plan here on earth, that is proof that there is a glorious future awaiting, that God doesn't just scrap it all, that God would make the effort using nations, using people, using judgments, coming, in different increments of time, intervening at strategic intervals, ultimately sending his son. See, obviously there's an objective. And God would not have preserved prophecies like this if they weren't important. God, what's the lesson to learn? The lesson to learn is that God is faithful. It doesn't matter how long it takes, but he will break the person who belongs to him. To the Israelites, he says in verse 28, for thus says the Lord God, surely I will deliver you into the hand of those who hate you, and from whom you alienated yourself. They will deal hatefully with you, take away all you have worked for, and leave you naked and bare. The nakedness of your harlotry shall be uncovered, both your lewdness and your harlotry. I will do these things to you because you have gone as a harlot after the Gentiles, because you have become defiled by their idols. You have walked in the way of your sister, therefore I will put her cup in your hand. So again, declaring the judgment that was going to come through the very ones that they were trusting in, the very ones that you went to find your hope in this world and your earthly security, verse 28, they will strip them naked, verse 29. There will be nothing left after this coming judgment. Israel was supposed to be a nation set apart, a nation set on a hill. And because God determined it, they will be. But this would cause them to be separated from the other nations of the earth, verse 30, suffering the same fate as their sister, the northern kingdom, verse 31. Thus says the Lord God, verse 32, you shall drink of your sister's cup, the deep and wide one. You shall be laughed to scorn and held in derision. It contains much. You will be filled with drunkenness and sorrow, the cup of horror and desolation, the cup of your sister Samaria. You shall drink and drain it. You shall break its shards and tear at your own breast, for I have spoken, says the Lord God. So here the cup, speaking of the cup of judgment, just like Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane, I'll take this cup of judgment. The size of the cup of judgment is emphasized in verse 32. In other words, the extent of the judgment is going to be severe enough to cause the Gentile nations, it's saying here, it's going to cause the Gentile nations that are around Israel, that God is seeking to make an impression upon, it's going to cause them to take note of what happens in Israel. Jerusalem would become a source of scorn and derision to surrounding nations, with the impact that it would have on Israel being emphasized in verse 33, filled with drunkenness, sorrow, horror, and desolation. The cup that Samaria had been given would be drunk and drained, verse 34, and then be broken into pieces. In other words, the judgment will be complete. You're going to drink the full cup and smash it. And God's judgment of the nation will be complete at that point. Therefore, thus says the Lord, verse 35, because you have forgotten me, cast me behind your back, therefore you shall bear the penalty of your lewdness and your harlotry. So this is the verdict, that they had forgotten God and cast him behind their back. Forgetting God implies former knowledge. I can't forget what I'd never known. Romans chapter 1 says that human beings have no excuse for not knowing that there's a creator. There's an innate knowledge within people. Animals cannot even entertain the concept of God as people can. Whether someone believes in God or not, you know, that's up to them, but they can at least theorize and think abstractly and, you know, think that there is a God. To forget that level of understanding requires a suppression of the truth, Romans 1:18 says. For people who want to be atheists, they have to suppress the truth, which carries its own judgment, but it will not be as severe. Passages of scripture like this say it will not be as severe as the judgment that comes upon those who forget God. Those to whom God reveals himself in a special way, but who then say, forget you, I'm going to do my own thing. God, I don't want anything to do with you. Such as apostate Israel, seen here, or the apostate Last Days Church, as you're seeing flourishing in our country right now. Someone who grows up in a Christian home but rejects the truth that they had been exposed to later in life, they will experience a greater level of judgment than someone who's never known God's truth but rejects their Creator. Both experience judgment. It's just that with greater understanding, there comes a greater judgment. If someone falls off a 5-foot ladder, and somebody else falls off a 5-story building, they both fall. But the consequences of falling off a 5-story building are a lot worse. That's how it is for someone who knows God and rejects him. In forgetting God here in our country and losing the freedoms and blessings that come with that, which we are rapidly losing, our fall as a nation will be much more severe and more painful due to our having known God's blessings to begin with. And that's what we're seeing take place. At the time of these prophecies, Israel's fall as a nation was similar. Having known God's blessings, they were mocked, they were derided by others because they were so blessed. It's the same thing that people are beginning to do to our country. As they see our country going down the tubes, it becomes a mockery, it becomes a source of laughter and derision. When a country that's been highly blessed falls, it becomes, you know, a center of mockery. Now, if they're focusing on Judah's judgment here specifically and ending up with this cup here, and because they've forgotten God, the prophecy returns to combined sins and punishments of the whole nation, north and south, at verse 36. The Lord also said to me, Son of man, will you judge Ahola and Aholabah? Then declare to them their abominations. For they have committed adultery, and blood is on their hands. They have committed adultery with their idols, and even sacrificed their sons, whom they bore to me, passing them through the fire to devour them. Moreover, they have done this to me. They have defiled my sanctuary on the same day and profaned my Sabbaths. For after they had slain their children for their idols, on the same day they come into my sanctuary to profane it. And indeed, thus they have done in the midst of my house. The words that introduce this passage, will you judge, there in verse 36, if you were to go back and look at this series of prophecies, that statement connects this with chapter 22, verse 2, and with chapter 20, verse 4, where the series of prophecies began when Ezekiel was called to judge this nation. Will you judge them, Ezekiel? So God's saying, you're going to sit as my judge. And so this becomes the summary now. At the end of this prophecy, it becomes a summary of this whole series of prophecies dealing with the same theme and communicated at the same time. The same charges, spiritual adultery and bloodshed are repeated, in particular verse 37, the child sacrifice that was practiced in Jerusalem at the time of their judgment, where they would throw unwanted babies into bonfires. It's a horrible practice. It's considered even more vicious today because it's commercialized. It's big business. People make a lot of money off of that. For those in Israel at the time, it was such an abomination because it was done right in the face of God. He says in verse 39, after they had slain their children, on the same day they would come into the sanctuary and profane it, God says. It would be like getting an abortion in the morning and going to church at night and thinking nothing of it. Just having, that's where their conscience, they have no conscience. No conscience left. Furthermore, verse 40, you sent for men to come from afar, to whom a messenger was sent, and there they came, and you washed yourself for them, painted your eyes, and adorned yourself with ornaments. You sat on a stately couch with a table prepared before it, on which you had set my incense and my oil. The sound of a carefree multitude was with her, and Sabians were brought from the wilderness with men of the common sort who put bracelets on her wrists and beautiful crowns on her heads. Then I said concerning her who had grown old in adulteries, will they commit harlotry with her now, and she with them? Yet they went in to her as men go into a woman who plays the harlot. Thus they went into Ahola and Aholibah, the lewd women. But righteous men will judge them after the manner of adulteresses and after the manner of women who shed blood because they are adulteresses and blood is on their hands. So this is portraying the reliance here upon earthly powers for their success and for their security. Their spiritual adultery was matched only by their political adultery, is the idea here. The nation's reliance upon foreign alliances is described here as a woman getting herself all washed up, verse 40, painted up, adorned, preparing a beautiful setting, verse 41, in which to entertain foreign dignitaries. Dignitaries of the lowest sort are depicted in verse 42 when it says the Sabians were brought from the wilderness with men of the common sort. The description is of the most coarse, vulgar, drunken men who would come into her. So this is the nations that Israel formed allegiance and alliance with. Such went into Israel, described as these two sisters again. They went into them as a man would go into a prostitute. But righteous men, verse 45, will judge them after the manner of adulteresses and women who shed blood. Speaking there of Ezekiel, Jeremiah, and other prophets who spoke out against this, as God is just laying down this judgment here for his people as their time had run out. And then in verse 46, for thus says the Lord God, bring up an assembly against them, give them up to trouble and plunder. The assembly shall stone them with stones and execute them with their swords. They shall slay their sons and their daughters and burn their houses with fire. Thus I will cause lewdness to cease from the land, that all women may be taught not to practice your lewdness. They shall repay you for your lewdness, and you shall pay for your idolatrous sins. Then you shall know that I am the Lord God. So here the sentence is imposed. He talks about there that the assembly, verse 47, shall stone them with stones. This is a sentence imposed according to Mosaic law, Leviticus 20, verse 10. The adulterer and the adulteress shall surely be put to death. Deuteronomy 22, verse 23. If a young woman who is a virgin is betrothed to a husband, and a man finds her in the city, lies with her, then you shall bring them both out to the gate of the city, and you shall stone them to death with stones. So that was the sentence for those in the law who committed adultery, to be stoned together. The young woman, because she didn't cry out, and the man, because he humbled his neighbor's wife. So the penalty for adultery was stoning to death. One of the punishments listed here in verse 47, to Israel's judgment and removal from the land, verse 48, all women will be taught through their removal from the land, all women will be taught not to practice this idolatry called lewdness. In other words, Israel's judgment will be a warning to all nations not to do the same thing. And in the end, Israel will know that God is Jehovah. They will come to a full recognition of who the true and living God is, it says at the end of verse 20 or chapter 23. The conclusion is to guard myself from idols. Worship God alone. Have no other God before God. Make no graven images and have no other gods. That is the lesson. So, Father, thank you for the lesson. Thank you for your word that you give to us, God, that we can know you and we can know, Lord, what is pleasing to you and what isn't pleasing to you. God, I pray that you would bless our prayer time tonight and that you would be glorified in our midst. In Jesus' name, amen.
So aimless, my life filled with sin. I wouldn't let my dear Savior in. Then Jesus came like a stranger in the night. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow. A blind man, I wandered alone. Worries and fears I claimed for my own. Then like a blind man, then God gave back his sight. Praise the Lord, yeah, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. I was a fool to wander and stray. Straight is the gate, narrow the way. Now I have traded the wrong for the right. Praise the Lord, yeah, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more.
Someone to pray with. Father, we thank you for just bringing the light into this world, Lord, that we can see and get saved. We love you, Jesus, and God, I pray you hear our prayers tonight. In Jesus' name, amen.